వారం మన గెస్ట్ ఐపీఎస్తో పాటు 2 పోస్ట్ గ్రాడ్యుయేట్ చేసిన హైలీ ఎడ్యుకేటెడ్ ఐపీఎస్ ఆఫీసర్. సార్, పెడుగొండ మీరు ఫస్ట్ పోస్టింగ్లో అప్పటికే ఫ్యాక్షన్ బాగా కనిపిస్తుంటుంది, పరిటాల రవి, జేసీ దివాకర్ రెడ్డి. అంటే మీ ప్లాన్ ఆఫ్ యాక్షన్ ఏ విధంగా ఉండేది?
ఎమ్మెల్యే ఆఫ్ పెనుగొండ ప్రయర్ టు ఎయిట్ మిస్టర్ చెన్నారెడ్డి, హీ వాజ్ కిల్డ్ బై ది ఫ్యాక్షనిస్ట్ అండ్ ఇట్ హ్యాస్ బీన్ రివెన్ విత్ పెన్ ఫ్యాక్షన్ ప్రాబ్లమ్ ఫర్ ఎ లాంగ్ టైమ్. Anandpur and Kadapa and Karnool traditionally have been known to be very badly affected by the faction problem.
Sir, meer Penigont lo work chestunappudu Hindupur elections sir perfect chesanu cheptunnaru, appudu political pressure avani meeku vachindi?
That is very easy and everybody gets tempted to blame the politicians. It is wholly incorrect.
Compared to UP
and Bihar, things are a lot more better. Andhra Pradesh and Telangana have forged ahead of most of the North Indian states.
Sir, Adilabad, Manchariyala, at that time, Godavar belt and the Naxals movement was at peak stage.
We had a very large number of problems in the coal mine area of RKpur, Belampalli. We had the Singareni coal mines and that was very, very badly affected by Sikasa. That was a huge challenge and at times Mr. Mahendra Reddy, myself and our team members in police station circles had to work actually almost round the clock. We did have a couple of exchanges of fire. I must tell you that there was incident of a baited ambush wherein they had killed a sarpanch and also burned down an RTC bus, thereby inviting senior police officers.
Sir, actually Naxals movement anadi landed problem a ledante poverty problem anu identify chesaru?
See, it is a combination of many factors and large number of studies have been done. Recently, Mr. Prakash Singh
sir, meeru vellina country lo dadapu oka koti mile land men chusaru sir, akkada pelutunde
one agaze correct. Yes,
Adilabad do ma Telangana ma land miners ki akkadiki difference enanante,
that was a time of cold war between these two countries, communist versus capitalist and all that. So that war had been going on for almost 20 years. One party that is MPLA, another certain areas was UNITA. So what they would do, they will put mines in their own area so that in case they lose, they will withdraw. Of the young men at that point of time in Angola were without legs. You will find so many handicapped people moving on calipers and support systems.
Srisailam Yadav rowdy shutter ni kuda meeru baaga tight chesinattla.
MLA colony had come behind it and they wanted access to the colony through the battalion. There was a lot of pressure on me to open the police station directions. I did not open the police station and I clearly put it on record that if you open the police station over there without adequate manpower, it is highly vulnerable to attack, it will be counter protective.
Sir, Rayalaseema IG ga unna time lo Puttaparthi Satyababu gari chanipovadam appudu chaala landed problem undi, bastulu chaala mandi vachadu, aa issue ni chaala cool ga meer ela deal chesaru?
I am not a great believer of babas and all that, and for almost 1 year while I was there, no, he did this and he gave me a watch, he did this and gave something to my wife, and then while he was giving me watch, he asked me a very simple question. I still remember, he said, what is the spelling of watch? He said, what does it mean? I thought he had something in mind. I said, sir, mere chepandi. Then he said, watch means, what a beautiful message he gave, this message of great wisdom.
Welcome to Crime Diaries. ఈ వారం మన గెస్ట్ ఐపీఎస్తో పాటు 2 పోస్ట్ గ్రాడ్యులు చేసిన హైలీ ఎడ్యుకేటెడ్ ఐపీఎస్ ఆఫీసర్, పేరు సంతోష్ మెహ్రా, అడిషనల్ డీజీ, డైరెక్టర్ ఆఫ్ తెలంగాణ పోలీస్ అకాడమీ. సంతోష్ మెహ్రా గారు ఐపీఎస్ ఆఫీస్తో పాటు ఐపీఎస్ కాకముందు బాగా చదివారు, ఐపీఎస్ అయిన తర్వాత ఫారెన్లో కూడా చదివారు. ఐపీఎస్తో పాటు ఎందుకు చదవాల్సి వచ్చింది, ప్రస్తుతం పోలీస్ అకాడమీలో ఎలాంటి రిఫార్మ్స్ తీసుకొస్తున్నారు, అతని డిపార్ట్మెంట్లోకి వచ్చిన తర్వాత నక్సల్స్ మూమెంట్ ఏ విధంగా ఉండేది అనే విషయాల్ని సంతోష్ మెహ్రా గారు తెలుసుకున్నాం. సంతోష్ మెహ్రా నమస్తే అండి.
నమస్కారం
సార్. మీకు రాయలసీమ ఐజీ నుంచి మేము ఫాలో అవుతున్నాం. మీరు ఎక్కడున్నా చాలా ఫాస్ట్ యాక్టివిటీస్ ఉంటాయి. రాయలసీమలో పుట్టపర్తి సత్యసాయిబాబా గారి ఇష్యూ అప్పుడు కూడా మీరు చాలా మొత్తం మా ఆ డివోటెస్ అందరూ ఎక్కువగా సెన్సిటివ్ అవ్వడం, ఆ ల్యాండ్ ఆర్డర్ ప్రాబ్లం లేకుండా మీరు చాలా డీల్ చేయడం, తర్వాత ల్యాండ్ ఆర్డర్ సిటీ, క్రైమ్ సిటీ, ఎడిషనల్ సిపి క్రైమ్స్, ఇవన్నీ చేసుకొచ్చారు. మధ్యలో మీరు బీఎస్ఎఫ్ కూడా చేశారు. అంటే మీరు డిఫరెంట్ సెక్టర్ చూస్తున్నారు. అంటే ఒక మీరు ఫస్ట్ పోస్టింగ్ వచ్చినప్పుడు నక్సల్స్ మూమెంట్ ఉండేది, ల్యాండ్ ఆర్డర్ రాయలసీమలో ఫ్యాక్షన్ చూశారు, బీఎస్ఎఫ్లో బార్డర్ ఆఫ్ సెక్యూరిటీలో కొన్ని చూశారు. ఇన్ని రకాలు చేస్తూ ప్రస్తుతం అకాడమీలో ఉన్నాం. మీరు అకాడమీలో ప్రక్షాళన చేస్తూ కొత్త రిఫార్మ్ చేయడం చేస్తున్నారు. ఈ ప్రశ్నలకి ఆన్సర్ చెప్పే ముందు అసలు పోలీస్ డిపార్ట్మెంట్లోకి మీరు ఎందుకు రావాల్సి వచ్చింది, మీ ఫ్యామిలీ బ్యాక్గ్రౌండ్ చెప్పండి.
యాజ్ యూ హ్యావ్ ఆల్రెడీ మెన్షన్ దట్ మై నేమ్ ఈస్ సంతోష్ మెహ్రా అండ్ ఐఎమ్ అన్ ఐపీఎస్ ఆఫీసర్ ఆఫ్ 1987 బ్యాచ్ ఆఫ్ ది అస్ట్ వైల్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ కాడర్ అండ్ ప్రెజెంట్లీ ఐఎమ్ ఆన్ తెలంగాణ స్ట్రెంగ్త్. ఐ జాయిన్డ్ ఇన్ 87 అండ్ ఆఫ్టర్ 2 years ఆఫ్ ట్రైనింగ్ ఐ వాస్ పోస్టెడ్ యాజ్ ఏఎస్పీ పెనుకొండ ఇన్ అనంతపూర్ డిస్ట్రిక్ట్, which at that point of time was the biggest subdivision covering 6 MLA constituencies and had police stations as far as Gandla Penta, NP Gunta, Tanakal, Talpula, which were almost 150 kilometers from the subdivision headquarters. Why I'm mentioning is that Anandpur at that point of time and perhaps even today has 14 MLA constituencies, assembly constituencies, and out of those 14, 6 were alone in one subdivision. So it was traditionally an IPS officer subdivision and I had great exposure at that time. Regarding why I joined the police service, I personally feel that at any level in the police, right from the constable to the highest rank, you have tremendous opportunity, tremendous potential to do public service, and the results can be seen quickly at the ground level. No other department touches a common man, particularly a poor man, as much as a police department.
ఓకే సార్, పెడుగొండ మీరు ఫస్ట్ పోస్టింగ్లో అప్పటికి ఫ్యాక్షన్ బాగా కనిపిస్తుంటుంది, పరిటాల రవి, జేసీ దివాకర్ రెడ్డి. అంటే మీ ప్లాన్ ఆఫ్ యాక్షన్ ఏ విధంగా ఉండేదండి? అంటే ఫస్ట్లో వాళ్ళకి కౌన్సిలింగ్ చేశారా లేదా?
సే దెర్ ఈస్ ఎ వెరీ ఫేమస్ సేయింగ్ దట్ ఇఫ్ యూ హ్యావ్ ఇంటెగ్రిటీ నథింగ్ ఎల్స్ మ్యాటర్స్ అండ్ ఇఫ్ యూ డూ నాట్ హ్యావ్ ఇంటెగ్రిటీ అగైన్ నథింగ్ ఎల్స్ మ్యాటర్స్ అండ్ దిస్ ఐ ఫౌండ్ టు బి వెరీ ట్రూ వైల్ ఇంటరాక్టింగ్ with the general public in the state of erstwhile Andhra Pradesh, the United AP. The people here in AP are very alive, very active, and they closely watch how the government servants are performing.
Yeah.
And if they find that a government servant is honest and impartial, both the things, and he is committed to his work, he is given tremendous regard, tremendous respect, and the work becomes a lot easier. So by the grace of God and the blessings of my elders, my seniors, somehow I had imbued and inculcated these qualities by virtue of my parents, and that became evident to the general public and to my junior colleagues in the police department, the subdivision, from the very beginning. The plan of action was very, very simple. We should reach the scene of offense as quickly as possible. We should examine the witnesses. We should have a very, very objective, very impartial registration of FIRs and the investigation process. Once the victim party as well as the accused party come to know that the police is impartial, they are prompt and they are taking action. They have faith in you. It is good deterrence to the culprits, to the criminals. And it also gives a lot of support, emotional support, to the victim party. So in very simple words, my plan of action was ensure prompt response to the complaints, to the grievances of the victims or the people who have any problem, and ensure that it is conducted, completed at the earliest, and no fear or favor should be brooked at any point of time. To my good luck, my seniors, my SP, my DIG were also very supportive, and we had a very, very good, very, very peaceful elections in 1989. I was, as mentioned, I was SDP of Panukonda. We had very peaceful elections. I was personally kept in charge of Hindupur constituency from where the then Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, late N.T. Rama Rao Garu, he fought the election, and he won the election from there. Though probably he lost from Kalwa Kurti in Mehboob Nagar, but he won from there, and I was personally in charge of the constituency, and there were no complaints. It went up very smoothly. However, in Gorantla constituency, there was some violence, and I would not like to name the person who was in charge because he has long retired also. There was certain repolling ordered, and again, because of the tremendous good work that was done in Hindupur constituency, I was made in charge, and during repolls, everything went off very smoothly.
Okay. Can I put a faction A movement?
Yeah, as we know, Panukonda subdivision, even the MLA of Panukonda, prior to it, Mr. Chinna Reddy, he was killed by the factionist, and it has been riven with many faction problem for a long time. We recollect that Mr. Paritala Ravi, who was subsequently minister also, he was also part of the faction thing. There had been Anandpur and Kadapa and Karnool traditionally have been known to be very badly affected by the faction problem. And as I had mentioned to you, prompt policing, efficient policing, impartial policing, and tough measures. We would ensure that the people are arrested, they are remanded, their bails are strongly opposed, they are kept in the jails, and we file charges promptly, and we see that the cases are convicted to the extent possible, at the earliest possible. That was our strategy, and it was effective. Okay. As I tell more, since the, the time period from the from the time the charge sheet is filed and the conviction happens is relatively long. The initial action taken by the police, which gets demonstrated in terms of registration of FIRs in an impartial way, picking up the fellows, arresting the fellows, carrying out proper interrogation, building up the case studies, remanding them and ensuring that they do not get bail, that itself is a very strong deterrence for further recurrence of crime, and also gives comfort to the victim party, yes, that they are being looked after well.
Okay. Sir, మీరు పెనుగొంటలో వర్క్ చేస్తున్నప్పుడు హిందూపూర్ ఎలక్షన్స్ చాలా పర్ఫెక్ట్గా చేశానని చెప్తున్నారు. అప్పుడు పొలిటికల్ ప్రెజర్ అవన్నీ మీకు వచ్చిందండి ఫ్యాక్షన్ థింక్లో.
See, it is not only confined to factions alone, I would say. In your job, you keep getting requests from people of different walks of life. And I must tell you, the correct position. It is very easy, and everybody gets tempted to blame the politicians. It is wholly incorrect. In fact, I have seen in my career that by and large, politicians are very rooted people. Their ears are very close to the ground. And we get a more objective and a very, very precise and correct feedback from politicians, than our own, I would say, colleagues and junior colleagues in the department. Somehow the very nature of bureaucracy is like this, that, and particularly so in uniform services, that people are relatively reluctant to approach us. And though we call ourselves as civil servants and, public service and servants of the public, but somehow a very large number of us tend to take a very condescending position towards the public. And therefore, political representatives, they play a very important role. At times, you do get requests which are not very reasonable. And I have seen in my career, particularly in this state, I'm from UP, Lucknow. And I have my batchmates there, we know about things over there. I have generally found that by and large, the political representatives in states in South India, in AP and Telangana, are far more reasonable.
No.
And if you explain the reasons to them in a very polite and dignified manner,
as to why certain things can be done and why certain things cannot be done, they get convinced.
Okay. And you compared to UP?
Compared to UP and Bihar, things are a lot more better, and that is why I feel that because of the governance and administration which has been given in these states, irrespective of the political party in power, Andhra Pradesh has gone forged ahead. Andhra Pradesh and Telangana have forged ahead of most of the North Indian states. That is why you have the term Bimaru. Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, UP, they are combinedly called Bimaru states. And I wish that, you know, my home state also progresses as the way Andhra Pradesh and Telangana have progressed.
Okay. Sir, Penukonda next.
Panikonda Tarvata, I was posted to Mancherial. And since you asked me, I'll tell that there was one politician who was responsible for my transfer, and he used to, this is I'm talking of 1990, and he used to tell me that if you do not listen to him, he will get me posted to Adilabad district. And somehow Adilabad district used to evoke feeling of fear and despair and certain amount of scare. So that was being thrown about at me to intimidate me to listen. And I said, I'll be very happy to go to work anywhere in Andhra Pradesh, because having come from Lucknow, it doesn't matter to me whether I am in Adilabad or I am in Vishakhapatnam or I am in any place. So I was posted to Mancherial, and that was a very, very good assignment. I found that the people in Telangana, particularly in Adilabad district, are very simple and very loyal. They were totally devoid of any cunning or any, devious thing in Telangana. It was really a pleasure for me to work as ASP Mancherial and subsequently as SP Adilabad. And though the assignment was very tough because of the Naxal problem, but my own colleagues in the police department, I would say 99% of them were extremely loyal people, very simple people, very good at heart, and totally devoid of any type of cunning in their behavior.
Okay. Sir, Adilabad, Mancherial, at time of Godavari, kani, Godavari belt and Naxals movement baga, chal peak stage.
Yes, yes.
Meer appudu combing, mere own ga combing cheyadam.
I would say as ASP Mancherial, we had a very large number of problems. In the coal mine area of RKpur, Belampalli, we had the Singreni coal mines, and that was very, very badly affected by Sikasa. Singreni Karmika Samiksha at that time, this I am talking of almost, 28 years back. And in fact, the present DGP of Telangana, Mr. Mahinder Reddy, was my immediate boss. He was additional SP Belampalli, I was ASP Mancherial, and under him Belampalli, Kagajnagar and Mancherial subdivisions were there. Those were extremely tough days. We had Sikasa in the, urban or semi-urban areas in the coal mines, and it was again force to reckon with. One small pamphlet printed by Sikasa and put or pasted in some Singreni coal mine that from tomorrow onwards all coal mines should be closed. And all coal mines actually would close down and no worker would come. So the word terror, what evokes terror, I came to know the way Sikasa used to function. And the task mandated to us by the government and my bosses was that we have to ensure that this band calls in coal mines are not allowed to, become successful. We should ensure proper safety and security for all the Singreni coal mine workers and their family members. They should not get scared by the Sikasa threats that they will be, killed or injured in case they attend the coal mines. That was a huge challenge, and at times Mr. Mahinder Reddy, myself and our team members in police station circles had to work actually almost round the clock. And those days, if I recollect correctly, if the coal mines would close down, the government used to suffer loss of 5 to 7 crores per day, which was a huge loss. And our entire efforts were directed in providing a very, very safe and secure environment to the coal workers. and ensuring that nothing untoward happens. So we, there will be round the clock patrolling, large number of pickets will be put, we'll be carrying out raids and searches to pick up fellows who are Singareni, I mean Sikasa,
yeah,
militants. And during the process, we had large number of, you know, episodes or events wherein many of the Sikasa terrorists were apprehended, and we proceeded against them as per the law. And to me, to my satisfaction, it was that their Band cause got totally, they failed to ensure, to see that the band, coal mines closed down, and the production increased in a very big way. Though initially we did have some setbacks, we did have a couple of killings by the Sikasa, but then we very swiftly were able to tide over the situation, and calmness, tranquility, peace were restored. And it was a matter of great satisfaction to me that coal mines became functional.
Okay, sir. Actually,
apart from this, yeah, again we had in the rural areas large number of dalams.
Mm.
We had the Vandalam in the Chinnur, Ori Chinnur and Kotpalli area. We had several other, Mangi Dalam was there, and they were also very, very, you know, active those days. We did have a couple of exchanges of fire. I must tell you that there was incident of a baited ambush wherein they had killed a sarpanch and also burned down an RTC bus, thereby inviting senior police officers. Because as per the police manual, the Telangana police manual or the erstwhile AP police manual, whenever there is a grave crime committed, an officer of the rank of DSP or ASP or sub-divisional police officer must visit the scene of offense. So they committed a murder and they also followed it up with a burning of a RTC bus, thereby ensuring that at least I will be there. But not only myself, my additional SP Mr. Mahinder Reddy, both of us actually were visiting those scenes of offences in Kotpalli police station limit, and at that place en route they had laid mines.
Mm-hmm.
They had laid mines over there to, you know, shall I say, kill both of us. But you know, jaise kehte hain ki marne wale se bachane wala bada hota hai. So God was kind, and both of us, we did not fall prey to their stratagems. And they ran away. We had a bit of an exchange of fire and they ran away. The landmines did not work to the way they wanted it. And finally, we recovered 7 big landmines which had been kept below the ground,
okay,
to kill the police parties. So somehow we survived, and that was a great lesson for us as to how we should strategize, how should we negotiate our way in kaccha areas, in the jungle areas, so that we do not get caught in ambushes.
Okay. సార్ యాక్చువల్గా నక్సల్స్ మూమెంట్ అన్నది లాండెడ్ ప్రాబ్లమా లేదంటే పావర్టీ ప్రాబ్లమా అని ఐడెంటిఫై చేస్తారు?
సి, ఇట్ ఈస్ ఎ కాంబినేషన్ ఆఫ్ మెనీ ఫ్యాక్టర్స్, అండ్ యునో లార్జ్ నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ స్టడీస్ హ్యావ్ బిన్ డన్ రీసెంట్లీ. మిస్టర్ ప్రకాష్ సింగ్, ఫార్మర్ డీజీపీ ఆఫ్ యూపీ అండ్ హూ హ్యాడ్ ఆల్సో బీన్ డీజీ ఇన్ నార్త్ ఈస్ట్ అండ్ హీ వాజ్ డీజీ బీఎస్ఎఫ్ ఆల్సో, ఇన్ హిస్ ఇంటర్వ్యూస్ హెస్ మెన్షన్ దట్ poverty, deprivation, corruption, leakages, etc., also contribute in a very major way to certain amount of disenchantment and disillusionment in the public, which gets tapped by Naxals.
Okay.
It is a fact. But then there have been instances where there have been certain amount of, I would say, high-handed behavior and lack of sensitivity on the part of law enforcement agencies, on the part of security forces, which also tend to alienate the public and aggravate the problem. So it is a combination of many factors, but I would imagine that once the police has cleared off a particular area of the Naxal influence, the development agencies should seize that opportunity to actively go in those areas, carry out development works, carry out poverty alleviation projects, ensure that delivery of services under various government programs, central and state government programs, actually reach the poor and the needy.
Yeah.
And if that happens, I am sure that this problem will have a permanent solution. We as police forces are able to give what I would say a strong antibiotic treatment, bring the infection or bring the disease under good control. But then if we want systemic solutions, institutional and long-term solutions, developmental agencies and other government agencies have a very, very important role to play have a very important role to play in these matters.
Okay. Sir, adula Bellampalli next post?
Adhyan tarvata, I had gone to Greyhounds.
Oh.
So I was in Greyhounds before that, you know, just after joining Greyhounds, I was sent to NSG as head of a group of people who were given a specialized training, commando training in NSG in Manesar. So after doing 3 months of NSG commando training, we came back to Greyhounds and we continued there for, I continued there till about, April 93. In Greyhounds, and we conducted large number of operations over there.
Okay. Next year, SP promotion.
Yeah, I got promoted in April 93 in the wake of a very major incident which has taken place in Vizag Rural, where the then MLA of, I think it was Chintapalli, Mr. Balaraju, he was kidnapped with a few other government officials, including one IAS officer. And Mr. Srinivaslu, who also happens to be my batchmate, Mr. Srinivaslu was subsequently released and a few others were released, but they wanted that till the time the one of the big time PWG, you know, Noxalite by name Kranti Randev, who at that time, you know, prior to his arrest, was responsible for the killing of some very important senior police functionaries. And he had been subsequently arrested and he was in jail. So the Noxalites wanted the PWG. Wanted that he should be released and then only they will
release
the MLA and other government functionaries. This stalemate continued for a very long time, for more than a month, etc. Somehow, you know, those people could not, this MLA and these people could not be tracked down, and the government had to release Kranti Randev.
Okay.
And that was a sort of an embarrassment or a setback to the efforts of the police department to, you know, in this anti-Noxalite, you know, work. And in the wake of this, I was posted as SP Vizag Rural. And thereafter, we had a lot of improvement was there in anti-Noxal work. And we had the achieved satisfaction of containing the menace to a great extent.
But operation alag mithi, sir. Balaraju and government official operation mire vedanga take up chesaru.
See, you know, a lot of people feel that it is Telangana, those Adilabad, Warangal, Nizamabad and Karimnagar were, you know, mostly affected. But I can tell you, having worked in Telangana as well as in Rayalaseema and as well as in Andhra area, that the toughest terrain, from the perspective of terrain I am talking, the toughest terrain is in the forest of Vizag Rural, East Godavari, Srikakulam, Vijayanagaram and the contiguous area of Orissa.
KOP.
Because you have large number of, you know, I would say hills are there, very thick forest is there, altitude is high and that makes it very difficult. Unlike Telangana, where you have relatively plain land. So, though you have forest cover in Telangana, but by and large the terrain is plain. Whereas in those areas, you have lot of hills and valleys, which makes movement of police forces very difficult and to track down the Noxalites. And the area, the coverage is also very huge and they have the advantage of, you know, crossing over to Orissa in case the heat increases. So therefore, we had to have a multidisciplinary strategy. And in fact, I would say I was the first SP in the erstwhile Andhra Pradesh to start the system of dance drama troops. So what I had done, we had taken a few, and it was a conscious decision, we had taken some very smart boys, SCs and STs who were part of our police force and who were very talented, and we had given them orientation in skits, in songs and small dances and drama things, and we used to send this team in interior parts of the Naxal areas, and the idea was that they will create awareness, not just confined to the anti-Naxal thing on the or the deleterious effect of Naxal things on the people, but also on several social issues. So this group of young boys and girls who were from these SCs and STs and part of the police department who had a special talent for dance and drama and singing, we gave them a lot of issues like the evils of drinking, then you know, caste system, and then also, you know, how to make use, best use of the government schemes, how to approach the government departments, plus, you know, matka, child marriage. Yeah. Along with that, certain, in a very subtle way, certain things on how youngsters will get their careers and lives spoiled by joining the Laksal movement, and how to avoid falling to the temptation of, you know, helping them, and then you get branded as militant sympathizers, and then there is a no-go because your police case is registered against you, and then it impacts your livelihood in future. You cannot apply for a police job. So in a very subtle way, it was a plan towards creating awareness about different government schemes, about apprising them of the evils, social evils, and how to handle them, how to, you know, improve their awareness level, to give them certain consciousness, and also to see that the Naxal thing is contained. That was one thing which I started, and I was the first SP. Later on, it became a statewide thing. SIB itself, you know, made dance drama troops, which were going all over the state. That was one thing. Second thing, we had a system of tribal home guards under the ITDA. So we had 100 tribal home guards given to us by ITDA, which we also used to do the regular home guard duties. Now, you know, myself being a management graduate, we do put a lot of focus on how things are phrased, paraphrased, and how they are branded. So instead of calling them home guards, and home guard tends to give a, you know, it has connotation of being something affiliated to a police, to security forces. We said no. Myself and the ITDA
project
director sat together, and we said we will call them social workers.
Okay.
And we'll broaden the spectrum of their duties. So we said we'll call them social workers, and they will go to the villages and provide us feedback about these living conditions. What are the problems being faced by the villagers in interior places, in the tribal areas, in the ITD areas? And that was a big success. So these 100 people overnight, instead of becoming home guards and being confined in terms of their vision and perspective and mandate to just doing some routine policing duty and only trying to find out about some stupid criminal or some fellow who is absconding or this, his mandate was increased. So he will go to the village, find out about the availability of water, about the presence of school teacher, whether the school teachers are coming or not. If at all they are coming, what is the standard of teaching, how many students are coming to the school, what is the quality of road network, and primary health center, doctors are coming or not, because these are the issues in tribal areas, you know. And the feedback that was coming from them was tremendous. The district collector, many other government functionaries came to know that at many places doctors were not coming, everything was only farji. False records, forged records were there, and that enables these social workers to gain a certain amount of acceptance amongst the public over there. And the services of the delivery of services also improved, because a very objective feedback was coming to the district collector and his machinery at the head office, at the headquarter level. It became a very independent source of feedback, which improved delivery of services. So therefore, the poor people were, and the tribals were happy, relatively happier. Another one thing which I did is that I wrote to the chiefs of all paramilitary forces, or what are now called Central Armed Police Forces, like BSF, ITBP, CISF, requesting them to send their recruitment teams to the tribal areas and do recruitment. Because in all these forces, there is a quota fixed for SCs and STs, which mostly goes unfulfilled. So I invited them. I said, you come send your recruitment teams and I will ensure that you get the requisite talent. And what we were doing along with ITDA, we would select from the villages certain youngsters who are relatively better, give them, you know, about 45 days, some 6 weeks, 6-7 weeks of good training. So whatever tests are prescribed at that time were prescribed for recruitment in terms of physical fitness, stamina, strength, 100 meters, 5 kilometer running, broad jump, high jump, etc. We started giving training to hand-picked people along with ITDA. And ITDA PO, Mr. Sumesh Kumar, who is now the He's the, you know, the principal secretary for commercial taxes, a very fine, very dedicated officer. He was extremely helpful and he provided a very good diet plan and good nutritional food to these youngsters. Due to which I'm very happy to say that almost 60-70 tribals got selected for CISF and other paramilitary.
Okay.
So we got a situation where on an average, you know, almost every village or 2-3 villages had one young man who was representing the government in the form of being a soldier in a central armed police force. So that was another thing. Then I can tell you that Mrs. Sujata Rao, who has now retired as secretary to the government of India, she was heading the health and medical services, and I requested her for some budget, and she was very generous. She gave us a substantial amount of money with which we used to purchase generic medicine, simple things like iodine tablets, iron tablets, folic acid tablets, because in these villages a large number of women and even men, lack of awareness and not having this iodized salt, they used to have this goiter problem. Yeah. Very common in agency area, this goiter problem. Then during pregnancies, women will not have sufficient iron supplement or folic acid supplement, and they will have abortions and all that. So my sub-inspectors will be visiting these villages with these very elementary nutritional supplements in terms of iron tablets, iodine tablets, folic acid tablets, a few things against prevention for malaria. So they were not costing the government much. And these sub-inspectors of police and inspectors will get greater acceptance ki gaon mein jaake they go around and they distribute them free of cost. So these were some of the measures which I took as SP Vizag ruler. Simultaneously, of course, we had trained commando teams, we had specialized teams to take on naxalites. We were very much focused on protecting our police stations. We used to conduct what was called PPD, post protection drills, so that in case there is an attack on a police station, our men are sufficiently sensitized and they are well trained to take on the naxalites, because those were the years when attacks on police stations had become relatively frequent.
Yeah, sir, be it time lo na le be tarvata gaani le be mundu gaani Anakapalli police mein ok attack aindi.
No, it was not in my time. It was
before
it happened earlier.
At be atvandi police mein attack cheyakunda meer prevention ga meer.
Yeah, there was not even a single instance during my tenure when any police station was attacked. No police station could be attacked, because I must tell you one thing. These PWG guys were very smart people. They will not carry out an attack or an ambush without getting thorough knowledge of the terrain, of the demo, of the place, about the movements of the police, about their preparedness, about the level of weaponry they have, type of weaponry they have, what are the features. They do their study in a very, very scientific and thorough manner. Only when they are convinced that their operation is going to be successful, then only they will carry out on track.
Oh.
So they surely got the feedback that here the chances of success are very less, because the policemen are well sensitized, they are well armed, they carry out this drill on a regular basis. In case they carry out and talk, the chances are that they will suffer reverses, they will have casualties or fatalities, and therefore they never even attempted it during my trial.
Okay. Sir, after Vizag?
After Vizag, I again came back as SP Adilabad district, and same thing was done on an even bigger scale, because Vizag district had only 42 police stations and Adilabad had 71 police stations. So a very large district, and even more different types of problems. Like Vizag had only PWG operating in the jungle areas and touching the rural areas, the rural police station areas. Whereas Adilabad, one, the size itself, the number of police stations are almost 70% more than what we had in Vishakhapatnam. Second thing was that you had also Sikasa to reckon with. It was more of a semi-urban or labor-oriented issue. You had greater number of dalams over there. They were better trained also. And we also had very, very communally sensitive places like Bhansa in Mudhol, which traditionally had seen lot of communal violence. So the bouquet of problems in Adilabad district were a lot more. And then it had as many as, if I recollect correctly, almost 15 major townships, ranging from Lakshatipet, Mandamari, Manchirial, Bhansa, Adilabad town itself, Kagaj Nagar. So more number of urban conglomerations were there, and urban policing was also part of it. So you had to focus on urban policing. You had to focus on Naxalite problem in terms of dalams in jungles, where the strategy, the weaponry is different. You had to also handle Sikasa, which used to carry small weapons and moves in lane and by lanes and in colliery means, which required a very different type of strategy and tactics. And you also had communal problems over there. And on top of this, Adilabad district, particularly the area which was bordering Jagtial and certain aspects of Karimnagar, were very vulnerable to dacoities. Large number of dacoities and robberies were common because the areas, the adjoining areas were very fertile, and therefore people had relatively more money. So dacoities and robberies was another important aspect of the work in Adilabad district.
Sir, Adilabad next time?
After Adilabad, I went abroad. I was in Angola as chief police personnel officer. And in Adilabad, actually, we had the elections. And I must tell you that this was a, I saw elections as ASP Panukonda. I saw elections as ASP Manchirial. And then that was the third elections in 94, October, November. I saw the elections. And that was the toughest period, I would say. Because all districts of Telangana which were badly affected, Warangal had one very big instance in which 10 APSP constables were blown in a landmine ambush. Nizamabad, the CRPF party was ambushed, a few people, I don't exactly remember how many, two or three people got killed, several got injured. In Karimnagar, which was part of the Karimnagar range, Adilabad and Karimnagar part of one range. In Karimnagar, in Manthri Muthuram area, the one BSF party was ambushed. Almost 10 or 11 BSF police personnel got killed, including the commandant himself. They had gone on a tractor trailer and they were ambushed. Their vehicle was blown. So they had been killed. So Karimnagar, Nizamabad, Warangal, all three places in the run-up to elections, there were very serious setbacks for the police department, several killings. And they had all the plans to carry out similar thing in Adilabad. What I had done, I recollect that I had almost 40 companies of paramilitary forces, including BSF, CRPF, SSB and CISF. And I told them that in interior places, you will not move on vehicles. You will only go on foot. You will not move on vehicles. And the CACR, the paramilitary forces are very much used to vehicles. They were very unhappy. And I must tell you, they complained to the bosses, to their bosses in Delhi, to my bosses in Hyderabad, that this officer is very strict and he's not even giving us vehicles and we are senior officers. How can we go on foot and all that? But then I must say that my top leadership was very supportive. In fact, these guys, I'm also a North Indian, but I tell you that these guys from BSF and all, they were mostly North Indians, and they used to think that they are very great fellows. They have handled terrorism in Punjab. They have handled terrorism in JNK. Or Andhra mein kya hai, the jungle mein chote chote log, they are very small in size, they move. So I held sensitization sessions for them, orientation training for them. And they were so full of themselves that many of them, the BSF guys, they refused to attend. Their commandant did not come saying, "Arey, ye kya sikhayenge? Humko to bahut aata hai." So then I put in writing, I said, "You must come and attend these sessions." And I took their officers on a field in Belampalli area. I took them around for about 20-25 minutes and I stood below some tree, some other places. We discussed and then I brought them to about 300 meters away, in a safe place which was well protected. And then I told my fellows to, now you start triggering the buttons. And then I told them, okay, that place, if you see, we were there around 20 minutes back. Did you see anything? No. Okay, you now you see. And then we blew and the landmine blast was there. So likewise, 3-4 places where they had visited along with me, where they were standing and could not realize, there were no telltale signs that landmines were there. We had actually planted them. Then they realized. I said, have you seen such things in Punjab? Punjab is all BT roads. You don't find landmines.
J&K?
J&K also, at that point of time in Kashmir Valley, there used to be exchange of fires, but the use of IEDs and landmines was very limited, almost non-existent. I said, this is a very different type of problem. And we have faced maximum casualties and fatalities in landmines, not in exchange of fire. So be prepared.
Yeah.
Then they understood and they were a lot more cooperative. And when this particular incident happened, when their own colleague commandant died in Karimnagar.
Okay.
Because he, against the instructions of the SP, went in a tractor trolley, he used a motorized transport and got killed. Then realized that the thing is serious. So, by the grace of God, we did not have a single untoward incident.
94
elections. 94 elections, assembly elections, went off very peacefully. And after the elections were over, I must tell you that Mr. Vijay Rama Rao was the director of CBI. And there was, you know, UN deputation proposals were there. Mm-hmm. I checked up in Delhi and they said, we don't know who is going to get selected. So, I rang up Mr. Vijay Rama Rao, he was director of CBI. I said, sir, I had applied for UN mission to Angola. And Angola is known for landmines and IEDs. I have worked in Greyhounds, I have worked in Vizag Rural, I have now SP Adilabad, and these places I am doing nothing except for handling landmines and IEDs. So, I think I am qualified. If you feel that I deserve, you kindly see, because he was member of the committee, he said, I'll look into it. And I got the orders from the government of India. So, from Adilabad, I went to Angola,
okay,
which at that point of time had the highest number of landmines in the world. A tentative estimate was that Angola in 1995 had almost 10 million landmines. 10 million landmines means 1 crore, 1 crore landmines in a country. So, I joined there in Luanda, in the headquarters, in the capital city of Angola. And somehow the commissioner of police was very happy with me. So, he took me as his staff officer for what was known as chief police personnel officer, something equivalent to, you can say, your IG law and order plus IG purse plus IG administration. So, these three things combined, I was for the entire country as CPPO in Angola, and for rotation, for deployment, for training, for administrative issues, I used to look into it. That was a very fulfilling experience, but much less in terms of number of hours of duty and stress as compared to being SP Adilabad. In United Nations, you know, if you work in a regular 10 to 5, it is more than enough. Whereas in Adilabad, you know, it may be, and it was used to be round the clock. And in fact, all my movements in Adilabad used to be in night time, because not many people know, there has been hardly any instance of land mining in the night time. Reason being, that for the terrorists or the Naxalites or PWG or what is called CPIML today, they do not resort to anti-pressure mines here. They use the mines which have to be triggered, not by pressure, but through their own remote control device. Now, the mine, the vehicle has to be on top of the mine. And when they are assured, when they know that, yeah, the vehicle has come on top of the mine, then they will express the exploder or they will activate the trigger mechanism, the detonation, by which the vehicle will be blown. Now, what happens in the night time? First of all, it's difficult for them to identify a vehicle as a police vehicle or it is a civil vehicle. That is one issue. Because they are hiding in the jungle at a distance of 100 meters. Gaadi kaun sa ja raha hai, it is difficult.
Yeah.
Second thing is, the vehicle has to be exactly on the top of the mine when it is triggered off. That becomes difficult in the night time because you can't see the road.
Yeah.
Therefore, you know, this is only we, the practitioners, know. So, all my movement in the district, like I am traveling from Adilabad to Belampalli, it used to be about 200 kilometers, take 3.5 hours. It will start only post 8 p.m. So, I will start after early dinner around 8:30, reach there at 12 in the night, spend a whole day, visit some places, and the subsequent early morning or the next early morning, I will start at 3 a.m. So that I am back in the hot cutter by around 6:30 by the time of break of dawn. So, from a time where we used to be traveling in the night time and working in the daytime, UN mission was a relatively very peaceful and stable experience.
Sir, you are in a country low. దాదాపు ఒక కోటి మైళ్ళను ల్యాండ్ మైన్ చూసారు అంటున్నారు అక్కడ పెళ్ళుతుంటే
వన్ కరెక్ట్
ఆదిలాబాద్ మన తెలంగాణ మ్యాన్ ల్యాండ్ మైనర్స్కి అక్కడికి డిఫరెన్స్ ఏంటంటే
దేర్ యాజ్ ఐ టోల్డ్ యూ ఇన్ అంగోలా దే హ్యాడ్ ది యాంటీ పర్సనల్ అండ్ ప్రెషర్ ట్రిగర్డ్ మైన్స్ ఆల్సో ఇన్ అంగోలా దే వర్ టూ పార్టీస్ యునిటా అండ్ ఎంపీఎల్ఏ దాండ్ దే వర్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ద సివిల్ వార్ సిన్స్ 1975 it was a Portuguese colony, and 1975 it got freedom and Portuguese left the country. Once they left the country, there was no proper or no smooth transition of power. So there was a civil war, and as it is widely believed, one party, that is UNITA, was being supported by USSR, and MPLA was being supported by US. That was a time of cold war between these two countries, communists versus capitalists and all that. So that war had been going on for almost 20 years. So finally, sometimes around 1990, the United Nations intervened, and they brought these warring parties to the table, and they said, okay, let us have an agreement, a peace agreement, by which we will ensure that the peace is established, disarmament takes place, all your forces are, disbanded, and they become part of the regular police force or the army of the country, and in a phased manner, and United Nations will oversee. That is how this mission, United Nations Angola Verification Mission, came about. Now, over these 20 years, certain areas were with one party, that is MPLA, another certain areas with UNITA. So what they would do, they will put mines in their own area, so that in case they lose, they will withdraw, and when the enemy thing who has won, they will come on the mines, and it will be triggered by the pressure of the presence of the person, and they will die. Due to which I used to find that large number of young men, their vehicles, their legs have been blown, a very large number, almost, it will be difficult for me to give an approximation, but I think at least 15% of the young men at that point of time in Angola were without legs. You will find so many handicapped people moving on calipers and support systems. So that was a very difficult thing. You had to be very, very careful. I was relatively lucky in the sense, or fortunate in the sense, that I was in the headquarter. Whereas many of my colleagues who were in the field, who were in regional quarters or what were called team sites, and they were part of the United Nations police observers or police monitors in the field, they were more vulnerable to the risk of being caught by landmines. For me, of course, one issue was there on a somewhat personal level, and I am a vegetarian. And Angola is a country with a long coastline. So the seafood in terms of prawns, shrimps, lobsters, crabs and all that was available in abundance. And vegetables were, very scarce. So there were just 4 vegetarians amongst almost 2000 people. And every weekend we had to go to a place 40 kilometers away, where something equivalent to our, mandi or a hut would be there. So we'll go there and purchase vegetables for a week. Many a time what will happen, because the civil war was still going on, though we were part of the United Nations, we were trying to see that things settle down, that road would also get mined again. And we'll get a advisory from what was called MAG, Mine Action Group, of another component of United Nations, will say it is no more advisable to travel on the road because we have information it has again been mined. So on those weekends, we will not even get vegetables. So we had to survive on raw bananas and raw papayas. So that was interesting. Of course, we were young people, so we could rough it out.
Okay. Can you put a climber man could play blast in Alipir? Climber man.
Yeah.
Ingola could a climber man, so only land miners.
I'm sorry, please come again. I didn't get it.
Alipir the climber man.
Climber
mans. Chandrababu Naidu.
Claymore, yeah.
Climber
yeah.
man.
Yeah.
Akkada Ingola kuda claymore man undu ledha only land miners?
In Angola. Angola had greater variety of mines than what we had seen in Andhra Pradesh. At that point of time, they had claymore mines, they had directional mines, they had IEDs, because it was a military war going on. So obviously, armies are better equipped in terms of arms, ammunition and other types of weaponry and stores compared to police forces, security forces, as well as the Naxalites. So in terms of the numbers of mines, in terms of the variety of mines, including claymore mines, Angola was a lot more dangerous. And that is why I told you that a large number of men had lost their limbs. A very large number of them got killed also in mines when they got caught directly. But I found that because those who were dead, you could not see them. They have been there in the graves. But we used to find in Luanda itself and many places, a lot of people without legs. Their legs had
Sir, after Lingo?
After Angola, I came back and I was posted as a traffic police chief. Those days, the traffic police chief was of DCP rank, which later on got upgraded to joint CP, and now it is additional CP. So I was traffic police chief in 96, and that was again rather eventful in the sense that Mr. P.V. Narasimha Rao was the prime minister of this country, and he visited this state more than 10 times in a period of 1 year. So every month we had to have a massive bandobas arrangements for the prime minister, which was really a, you know, it's a very difficult job. And that was a time when LTT in Sri Lanka was very active. We had large number of instances. We already had the instance earlier of our prime minister Mr. Rajiv Gandhi being killed in Tamil Nadu. And around that time when I was the traffic police chief, this is of course 96, so in between 90 to 95, there were several instances of assassinations in Sri Lanka by human bombs. We had their defense minister, if I recollect his name correctly, Ranjan Vijayaratne or somebody. He was traveling in his convoy and two, three bombers, human bombers came on motorcycles and they just rammed them, their motorcycles in his convoy, killing everybody. We had the instance of their Prime Minister Prem Dasa being killed. He was in an election campaign. He was moving on the road, and though the security guys had kept a sanitized zone of about 20 meters around him, they stopped a cyclist on whom they had suspicion, and immediately he blew himself and everybody got killed. So there was a naval chief. So there would have been at least 4 or 5 instances wherein in Sri Lanka, human bombers who had killed VIPs, politicians, senior defense generals on the roads. So to me, the biggest apprehension used to be that when the prime minister's convoy is moving, we have to sanitize the roads, and roads is the responsibility of the traffic police. And there will be so many lanes and by lanes, so though we would have the barricade and there may be two constables protecting it, because you can't be present, after all you have limited forces. But then if there is a determined attack, if there are large number of fellows and if they come, it becomes difficult. So that used to be a huge challenge, ensuring number one, the safety and security of the Prime Minister of India. And number two was that once his convoy has passed, to carry out clearance of the traffic which has accumulated as quickly as possible so that people are not put to greater inconvenience. So that was again very, very challenging. And I find that traffic policing is a very, very difficult job. It is something that it is not understood. We feel that those who are in greyhounds and octopus, they are performing a very risky job and therefore they get 50%. I have worked in greyhounds for a long period. I have been XP of Naxal affected areas. Let me tell you that the risk element is definitely there, because you get involved in exchanges of fire and all that. But if when you come to day-to-day risk, the risk, the pressure of job, the dangers to his health, there is no other job in policing which is more difficult than that of a traffic policeman.
Yes, correct.
And this I learnt when I was traffic police chief. Today, if you stand on a junction and you are there for just 10 minutes, you will find you have inhaled so much of dust and smoke and soot. That is one thing. There are large number of vehicles which are blaring their horns, which is impacting your ears. You have to be there standing continuously, because if a traffic cop vacates his position for even 2 minutes on Indian roads, there is chaos. Unlike, I was in USA and Australia also for 2 years each. Unlike those countries where you don't find a traffic cop, everything is regulated by signals. That signals, they regulate the traffic. People are law abiding. Depending on the signal, green or red, they will accordingly act. They will respond. But in India, even if you have traffic signal but you do not have a constable, there is chaos. It speaks very poorly of us as civic people who are civic conscience and who have law abiding. Therefore, even on a traffic junction, if you do not have a constable, it becomes very difficult. This guy had to be standing continuously without water, without anything, for 6 to 8 hours, and all throughout his inhaling noxious fumes and dust and smoke, etc. So that is why that was the first time we started two things. We tied up with AP Chest Hospital in Eragadda, and we started a system of 6 monthly thorough medical checkup of the constabulary, of the traffic constabulary. That was one thing, so that in case there is some deterioration, something, we can request the commissioner of police to shift him to law and order and any other duty. That was one thing. We got that entire thing formatized in consultation with the doctors. X-rays have to be taken, his hemoglobin level has to be checked, his PFT, pulmonary function test, has to go formed. So whatever tests were required to see his health condition were incorporated in a detailed thing. Medical sheets were opened for every traffic cop. That was one thing I started. The second thing which I started was that we gave them, we started the practice of giving them this water and lemon water and a little bit of jaggery and some other thing as part of a packet during the summers. So every 1 hour vehicle will go around and will hand over to the traffic constable water, lemon water, yeah, and some sort of jaggery, so that he is able to rehydrate his body and also energize himself with something like jaggery or vellum, which is
vellum. No,
so I found my traffic police experience to be extremely satisfying professionally. A lot of changes we could bring about. We had interface with the REC Warangal, which has a traffic and transportation department. We got in touch with Central Road Research Institute. We conducted out certain projects over here. Time and motion studies were conducted to know the, you have an assessment of the number of vehicles, the carriage on the number of vehicles which pass on the roads. We also had a bit of an issue wherein a PIL was put in High Court and we filed a reply. Mr. Prabha Shankar, Mr. Honorable Justice, was there. And when we brought all the facts to the notice of His Lordship, he was also very surprised, and he gave, after a series of hearings, he gave very detailed and very comprehensive instructions. One direction of the Honorable High Court of Andhra Pradesh was that whatever money is collected by the traffic police through fines and challan amount, that should be put up at the disposal of the traffic police for improving the traffic infrastructure. Okay. That was a landmark judgment. Second direction that he gave was that the traffic police chief should be part of the committee which is headed by the then MCH and now JHMC commissioner, which looks into giving clearances for commercial and residential projects. And environmental impact analysis, traffic impact analysis should be done before permissions are given for commercial and residential complexes. So these were some of the directions of the Honorable High Court which they gave in pursuance of the detailed replies we filed, giving comparison of the traffic situation, the manpower, the equipment, the resources available with the different metropolitan cities in India like Mumbai, Calcutta, Chennai and Mangalore. These 40 cities I have taken the comparative thing, and it was a very, very positive development. And the government of Andhra Pradesh at that time implemented them to some extent.
Okay. So traffic next.
After traffic, I came again to Greyhounds, earlier job. So I was there for about 8 months, and after Greyhounds, one fine morning I got a call that I have to go to Kurnool district. That was a time of partial prohibition, and there were reports to the government that a few of the public representatives, they were also part of the illicit smuggling of liquor, etc. And the government took a very serious note of it. My predecessor was Mr. Surendra Babu, who has now gone to AP Cadre. He is again an outstanding officer, a very upright and honest officer, and a very close friend of mine. And therefore, I was reluctant to go because I felt that he is a very fine officer. He is doing a great job, and therefore, he should be continued. But then, I do not know whether I should be saying it on the TV, the caste factors came into play and they said that you are Mehra, you are a North Indian, nobody knows what your caste is. So, you have the traditional thing over here in Andhra Pradesh, and he belonging to a particular caste was being looked upon with a certain amount of suspicion, despite the fact that he was absolutely upright, impartial, very professional in his approach, nothing but sometimes perceptions guide, decision making, instead of the realities of the ground. So anyway, I was posted, and being a member of discipline force, I joined there. I continued in the same way as my predecessor, who in any case had been doing an outstanding job. And the government was very happy with me. and then the elections happened again. Somehow I have this thing that wherever I get posted, somehow the elections come. So the parliament was dissolved, I think Deve Gowda or Gujral, and parliamentary elections were announced. And Karnool had a very, very close, fight. We had Mr. Vijay Bhaskar Reddy from Congress, and we had Mr. K. Krishnamurthy from the TDP side, and TDP was in power at that time. And we had another constituency in Nandyal. But we had a very good team. Mr. Rajeshwar Tiwari was the collector, Mr. Harpreet Singh was the joint collector, and I was there. And with absolute teamwork, we managed to ensure that the elections are totally incident-free. Though there was a lot of apprehension that the elections are going to be very bloody because of the faction thing and all that. But we put large number of people from both the parties under preventive detention. Under preventive detention we put them. So those who were the most, the people who were likely to create most trouble, they were all put under preventive detention in the run-up to the elections. So to a great extent, this threat or this apprehension of having large-scale violence in the run-up to election was taken care of. We had very peaceful election. I got a commendation from the Election Commission of India also for the same. Myself, Mr. Harpreet Singh and Mr. Rajeshwar Tiwari, all three of us got. And Oscar Wilde has said that no good thing goes unpunished. So accordingly, after the elections, we were transferred out.
Okay. Sir, next, Karnool next.
After Karnool, I became the commanding officer of 1st Battalion, Yusuf Gowda. And that was again a very different type of experience. Not many people know that 1st Battalion APSP and now what is called 1st Battalion TSSP is the biggest battalion in the country in terms of number of companies. It has got 9 companies. Normally most battalions will have 6 to 7 companies. Most army battalions these days have 4 companies. So it is the biggest battalion in the country, and it has a very hoary, very, very distinguished and checkered past. It was raised in the 1950s, and when it was raised, it has a sizable number of Gorkhas and even Nagas as part of the battalion. And their children and grandchildren continue to be part of this battalion. They have stayed, their parents stayed, and they grew up over here, and they love this job, so they were part of this battalion. And there were a few interesting things. Originally, this battalion was spread over 240 acres. And when I took charge in 97, somehow, on the margins or periphery of this battalion, a lot of encroachments and land grabbing has taken place.
Yusuf Gowda
battalion. Yeah. And over a period of time, that became part of the so-called Jubilee Hills, so very prime land. So almost we had lost as much as 35 to 40 acres of land of the original battalion campus. So that was very disturbing, and you can imagine that if we get back that 35 acres, it will be worth, you know, hundreds of crores in that area. But anyway, what had been lost, and you know, a lot of litigation, there was nothing we could do about it. But then we started the process of having a boundary wall and also getting construction of our constabulary quarters on the periphery or margins. That was to discourage some big time fellows from further encroaching upon the the battalion land. So that was
అప్పుడు మీకు ఒక రౌడీ షేటర్ శ్రీశైలం యాదవ్ తో కూడా మీరు శ్రీశైలం యాదవ్ రౌడీ షేటర్ ని కూడా మీరు బాగా టైట్ చేసినట్లారు.
Yes, we see what has happened, that a particular the MLA colony had come behind it, and they wanted access to the colony through the battalion. Now, battalion traditionally, whether it is an army battalion or a paramilitary battalion, it is out of bounds for the civilians, for the general public, and rightly so, because a battalion will have armories, it will have training going on, it will have firing practice going on, and if civilians are allowed, it can things can get out of control. And then once you allow people access in a battalion, then your armories, your bell forms, etc. also become vulnerable to attack. And those were again the times of Naxalite things. They have already done similar things in Koraput and many other places.
Yeah.
So despite tremendous pressure, I stood my ground, and I said no way we can allow access through the battalion. So in that I had to face a little bit of pressure, but then somehow we could better sense prevailed upon all concerned, and the DGP was also supportive, and finally the matter was shelved. Now that you mentioned this, I will recollect one instance of Adilabad which I actually forgot to mention, something very important. And I am telling it ki how, you know, if decision making is not done properly, how it can result in severe losses. There is a place in Adilabad which is called Sirpur U. One is a Sirpur Kagas Nagar, yeah. And there is another place called Sirpur U, which again was a very interior place, that area was very badly affected by the Naxal problems. They had a police station there long time back. So though you had the Naxal problem, but all belt being tribal, and generally in tribal areas, people are very innocent, very simple. They do not resort to routine type of crime like thefts or dacoities or robberies or murder and all. So it was, barring the Naxal problem, it was totally peaceful. Second thing, it was a very interior place with no road connectivity and very thick jungle. Third thing, it was very much, you know, under the influence of the Mangal Dalam. I will not name that gentleman, but the then public representative, one gentleman, was putting tremendous pressure for that police station to be opened. Those days when the Naxal problem was very, very, you know, serious, if you have to have police station, you have to have it self-contained and totally independent in terms of manpower. So anything less than 50 people, if you are having a police station, it is vulnerable to attacks. And a place like Sirpur U, which had no road connectivity, the possibility of reinforcements coming in time was also very less. It would take people at least 10 to 12 hours of continuous traveling on foot to reach this police station, and 10 to 12 hours is a long period when that the operation, if there is an attack, it would be over. So I strongly resisted and refused to open that police station. I said, first of all, the routine crime, the general crime in that police station is non-existent. I gave them record of that area, there was no crime. Second thing, I said, if we have to have police station, we will require that much manpower, which we cannot afford, we do not have the manpower. Third thing, there is no connectivity. So this police station has not been there for a long time. Let us leave the things. There is hardly any crime. And there was a lot of pressure on me to open the police station directions. I did not open the police station, and I clearly put it on record that if you open the police station over there without adequate manpower, it is highly vulnerable to attack. It will be counterproductive. As long as I was there, somehow I could prevent the opening of the police station. I went to Angola, and later on the police station got opened after about 2-3 months of my departure. The police station got opened, and as I had predicted, within a few weeks of the opening, the police station was attacked. All policemen were killed. All policemen were, including the SI, was killed, and the police station was bombed, it was blasted, it was totally demolished. So this instance, when I came to know I was in Angola, I was really shocked and deeply disturbed and greatly anguished, because I felt that this should not have happened. It was a major strategic mistake on our part to have opened that police station. There was no necessity for it, and we rendered our vulnerable, and it was a huge setback to the morale of the police force.
So suddenly, taravat vachina SP evaru andi akkada,
whoever. Doesn't matter.
Okay.
It has happened. It happened. And it is on record. It happened. Very unfortunate.
Okay. Sir, after that, 1st Battalion?
Yeah. 1st Battalion was actually, you know, when I became the commandant, that I realized that again in a battalion, for the men in a battalion, the commanding officer or the commandant is like a god.
Yeah.
And he's supposed to take care of their training and their welfare and all. And their demands are very simple, very elementary. Somehow in the battalions over a period of time, because of relatively greater focus on, you know, policing, field policing and on commando operations, the battalions meant, you know, daily routine operations and their administration had suffered. And I was in 1st Battalion and Mr. Surendra Babu was 8th Battalion, Kondapur.
Yeah.
And both of us worked in together. In fact, we were tasked with, you know, with preparing a project report as to how they improve the administration of battalions and their operational efficiency, and to prepare a roadmap for their growth. So both of us put our heads together and we gave a detailed report to the government. And when we did this study, we found that the number of battalions indeed in the then United Andhra Pradesh were very few. compared to most other states. If I recollect correctly, at that point of time, this I am talking of 97, 98, we probably had 12 or 13 battalions only, around 12 battalions we had. Whereas a state like Kerala had 18 battalions, which is not even one third of us. So most other states, UP had more than 60 battalions. Most other states had at least 30 to 40 battalions where we had only. So we gave that, giving the figures of the number of, in terms of area to be covered, in terms of population to be covered, in terms of the problems that we have in Rayalaseema, which will require large-scale deployment of armed police, in terms of the Naxal problem, in terms of the communal problem, we had given a detailed report giving the number of battalions that we have. Good thing is that after the division, it has been implemented to a great extent after the division of the state into Telangana. So now the overall, I think both AP and Telangana combined, we do have, I think, around 30 battalions, which is a decent number. So that was initially, sort of, I would say, our report, Mr. Surendra Babu and my report probably triggered it off. That thinking in the government that the need for having more battalions, and that has a great impact on routine maintenance of law and order. They, to a great extent, supplement the civil policemen in the police stations, and they relieve them of the routine duties of carrying out the sentry duties, maintaining the post, etc. So that has worked. Second thing, we put tremendous focus on training. So training got a lot of emphasis and impetus, and we had a system of rotational training. We improved the fitness of our men. And that was the first time that APSP Raising Day was celebrated. First time we had a raising week, full 1 week we celebrated the raising of the battalions. And that was very prominently featured in the media. And that greatly boosted the morale of the battalions across the state.
Okay. Next to promotion, sir, DAG.
Yeah, then actually for a short period, I was in Vigilance and Civil Supplies in Visakhapatnam. And I told the then DGP and all that, see, this is not a bad department meant for me. There's so much, it is civil supplies, vigilance cell was rampant, it was badly affected by corruption. So I was there for just about 3-4 months. All my, almost the inspectors got either suspended or got charge memos. And they all collectively tried for my transfer. I was also not very happy there. So then I came out, it was good riddance for them, good riddance for me. So I came back. Then I got my promotion after a few months being in the headquarters, AIG headquarters, for a short period, 3 months there, where I was entrusted the responsibility of doing the proofreading of the revision of police manual. Mr. Vijay Rama Rao had carried out the revision of AP police manual, and I was asked to do a little bit of proofreading and see if it has been there any mistakes, grammatical or construction of sentences, anything has been left out by chance. So I did that, and then I was posted as DIG Additional Director in Anti-Corruption Bureau.
Okay.
And I was Additional Director City and Telangana. Yeah. There used to be three, one for Rayalaseema, one for Andhra, and one for City and Telangana. Telangana and City and Telangana was the most important Additional Director. And it was that was a job which I loved a lot. I was there for about 1.5 years with large number of cases, disproportionate cases. Mr. Prasad Rao was my immediate boss, who was subsequently the DG also. And after that, I went to USA for 2 years.
Okay.
So I gave GRE and TOEFL, and by the grace of God, I got very good marks in GRE. So I got good fellowship from the USA, from that Bush School of Governance. And it was some sort of supplemented by later on by a scheme of the Government of India called Scheme of Partial Funding. So I took my family along, and I was lucky to get a bit of a, you know, what in Texas A&M University. That's a land grant university, so they had their own township. So I got a small 2-bedroom furnished apartment also over there as part of, as a very subsidized rate. And in any case, in USA up to class 10, education is free. So both my children were there, so their education was free. That pickup and dropping by is also organized by the school. So we spent 2 years, actually slightly less than 2 years, and I did my master's in public service and administration, focused on things like homeland security, counter-terrorism, intelligence collection, etc. While I was returning, I had applied for another fellowship, what is called Rotary World Peace Fellowship. And
Bush School.
No, this was in USA in Bush School.
Yeah.
There is another very famous, very internationally known fellowship called Rotary World Peace Fellowship.
Okay.
So they have their tie-up with two major universities in USA. One is the Berkeley University, which is very famous, and second is the Duke University in North Carolina. So, and they have another English speaking in England, one in Australia and Queensland, University of Queensland, Brisbane. I got admission in Berkeley University and in Queensland University. Then I discussed with my wife. She said, USA to pura dekh liya, ghum liya 2 saal mein. To abhi Berkeley jayenge, though it is more prestigious, but then it will be more of the same. So we took the offer to go to Brisbane, to University of Queensland. So then again I came back and I was in Hyderabad, and I applied for the required permissions from state government and government of India. I got the permission and I went there. Important thing is, in both the things, fellowships, I got it on my own. They were not government sponsored programs. Oh. Of course, I did go on study leave and tour on duty. So 3 years of this, about 3.5 years period, was covered by tour of duty, which is an official thing, and also the study leave. And but then the bulk of the funding was done by those bodies only.
Okay, okay.
So in this Rotary World Peace Fellowship also, it was fully funded by them. The entire education was funded by them, and they were also giving for living expenditure something like $2,100 Australian per month, which was again comfortable. So at that way, it gave me an opportunity to stay in two different countries, two different parts of the world, Northern Hemisphere and Southern Hemisphere, for almost 3.5 years. And it broadened my horizons, and I got to know this level of education, studies, standards of teaching in these parts, and could get updated with my knowledge. So I left in 2003 July, and finally returned in January 2007. But the most painful part is that when I returned, and I have got specialized knowledge in homeland security, in counterterrorism, in high-tech methods of intelligence collections. But then the government again posts me to Anti-Corruption Bureau. So all the knowledge which I has gained over 4 years, or roughly 4 years of detailed studies in US and Australia, it's not put to use. So this is the way things function. And I don't want to name the DGP. There is actually a laid down protocol that when an officer comes back from a foreign country, he has to be debriefed. He has to submit a report, and he has to be debriefed by the concerned department, the intelligence department, on different aspects and regarding the utility of the course and all that. So I gave a full-fledged report, but nobody bothered. I don't think so anybody read it. I mentioned to the DGK, I'll give a presentation. I was...
Again, joined to ACP.
So I joined ACP. It was actually a good job. I liked it. But the sad factor is that whatever knowledge which I had gained, the skills, the expertise I acquired, it could have been put to a better use at that point of time. Had it been utilized in the field or branch for which I got all this thing, it did not happen. So then I was in Anti-Corruption Bureau for about 4 years, and I had some excellent bosses in Mr. Girish Kumar and Mr. Arvind Rao.
Yeah.
They were very active, and we did a lot of cases, and that way I would say that very interesting that while we find that there's a lot of corruption in the different departments, but then unlike North Indian states, anti-corruption bureaus in South India, particularly in AP, has tremendous functional autonomy. I know in my state UP or in my state Bihar, even for a 500 trap, the DG has to write to the government. By the time the permission comes, 1 month is over. But here the DG ACB can order anything. Except for a proceeding against All India Service Officers, ACB DGB has all powers. And they were well utilized, and we did large number of cases. The number of DA cases, criminal misconduct cases, traps, surprise checks were all time high. And both Mr. Arvind Rao and Mr. Girish Kumar were extremely supportive. And after that, then Mr. Girish Kumar became the DGP, and he actually offered me whether you'd like to go as CP Vishakhapatnam or as IG Rayalaseema. So I said, I'll go as IG. Then he was very surprised. He said, everybody would like to go as CP. But then my perspective was that CP as CP of Vizag, I'll be doing the same job which I was doing in 93, 94 as SP. There is nothing much to do, nothing more to learn. Whereas IG, I will have 5 district SPs and 2 range DIGs. So it will be a very different type of job. I'll have the opportunity to have an overall perspective of 5 districts, 5 police districts, because Tirupati is a different police district. So I said, sir, if it is possible, I'd like to go as IG Rayalaseema, and then I came to
sir, Rayalaseema IG ga unna time lo Puttaparthi Satyababu gari chanipovadam appudu chaala landed problem undi bhaktulu chaala mandi vacharu ఆ ఇష్యూని చాలా కూల్గా మీరు ఎలా డీల్ చేసి
ఎస్ యు నో ఇన్ ఫ్యాక్ట్ దాట్ గేమ్ మీ ట్రిమెండస్ ప్రొఫెషనల్ అండ్ ఐ వుడ్ సే స్పిరిచువల్ సాటిస్ఫాక్షన్ బికాస్ యాజ్ ఐ టోల్డ్ యూ ఎర్లియర్ ఐ స్టార్టెడ్ మై కెరియర్ అస్ ఏఎస్పీ పనుకొండ అండ్ పుట్టపాతి వాజ్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ది సబ్ డివిజన్
పెనుకొండ.
ఐఎమ్ నాట్ ఎ గ్రేట్ బిలీవర్ ఆఫ్ బాబాస్ అండ్ ఆల్ దాట్ అండ్ ఫర్ ఆల్మోస్ట్ వన్ ఇయర్ వైల్ ఐ వాజ్ దేర్ though I was visiting Puttaparthi all every month since the chief minister was Mr. Chennareddy who was a great devotee of Baba and he would come every month and because the CM will be camping I'll be camping there but I never sought any appointment with Sai Baba. Then I got married and when I got married after a year or so my wife was insistent that you see they famous hain they bade hain I was still very reluctant. Then she told me okay if you do not consider him to be a divine soul, at least he is an elderly person, we are just married, what is wrong with taking the blessings of an elderly person. I said chalo, continuously every day being told that chal chalte hain. And when I met him, of course I had seen him in, you know, during these meetings and all, but that was on a more personal one-to-one basis. I found him to be extremely erudite, very compassionate, very articulate and a man of great maturity and wisdom. I am talking about Baba. And my perception of him changed and he did this and he gave me a watch, he did this and gave something to my wife and then while he was giving me watch he asked me a very simple question, I still remember. He said, what is the spelling of watch? So I said, maine kaha yaar IPS officer se ye pooch rahe hai, such a simple thing. I just rattled out watch. So he said, what does it mean? I was a little, I said, sir, it means to observe something, to see something intently. Bole, what else? I thought he had something in mind. I said, sir, mere chepandi. Then he said, watch means, watch your words, actions, thoughts, character and heart. See, watch, words, actions, thoughts, character and heart.
Baba.
He said, if you watch these things in your life, you will be happy, people around you will be happy and you will be successful. What a beautiful message he gave. This message of great wisdom. So I was very, you know, overwhelmed with, affection and regard and respect for him. And I really thanked my wife for, initiating the whole thing and persuading me, persisting with me that we must. So later on, and I'll tell you the watch which he gave me, and this is 1990. It stayed with me till I was in Australia. It lasted me 16 years and it was a citizen watch with a golden dial. But something very interesting, whenever something, some sort of a setback or some sort of a difficult situation was likely to come, this golden dial will start losing its color mysteriously. It will start becoming white. So the first time it happened, I thought, अरे ये क्या है, कुछ खराब watch है, substandard watch है, क्या है, कैसे हो रहा? But then again, the problem is over and again this golden color will be restored. So the first time I could not develop that sense of of relating the two. Then it happened the second time. Then it happened the third time. And then I realized that it was perhaps Baba's ways or a divine way of alerting me, cautioning me towards some sort of a problem or a situation which is going to arise. Therefore, my mental faculties and all, I should be more alive and alert to handle it. Yes. And it therefore, though, I was just married and I had a relatively better watch, having a day and date, all this thing. This was a very simple watch which Baba had given me. I kept that watch for 16 years. And I found that whenever some problem or a new challenge was coming up, it will start whitening itself. And later on, it will again, the original color will be restored. I have no explanation for it. I just do not know how it used to happen, but it would happen. So I developed certain faith in Baba. And when I came as IG and he was not well for a long time, and then I had to camp in Puttaparthi because large number of people, I won't name them, vested interests were there. They wanted that board, Baba's, that trust to be disbanded. and they imputed motives. They put large number of allegations, baseless allegations that Baba was being subjected to slow poisoning and all that. And there was tremendous pressure upon me from one particular, I won't name him and he's no more also, not just one, many people, to get FIRs lodged against the trust people. So that, process of investigations start and then we can say, inke khilaf to cases hai, and then the proposal should be moved for disbanding the trust and then putting their own people. But I resisted it, and I can tell you that the trust in Puttaparthi, looking after this, is comprised of some very, very exceptionally fine persons. I do not know the present status because I have been away and I was away to BSF, but I can say in 2010 when I took charge until 2011 and when Baba expired around that time, each one of them was a man of great honor, dignity, highly dedicated, people with very austere, very Spartan, very simple living, and they just were spotlessly clean. And I thought that if we allow any case to be registered against them, it will be not only a crime on my part, it will be something highly unethical and immoral on my part. So I just did not do any such thing and strongly resisted. And we somehow, we were there, and then Baba finally, he died, and we were expecting a certain amount of violence. But then we had put the system and mechanism in place. The police forces were already ready to be deployed at short notice. And at that time, we had almost, 5 lakh people coming, and there's just one Nungal Road, large number of VIPs, including the Prime Minister, Chief Ministers, Governors came, the Prime Minister himself came, Sachin Tendulkar came, large number of cricketers came, and it went over about 4 or 5 days, but the arrangements were good and everything went off. But of course,
sir, after his legacy lives.
Sorry?
After
Again in Rayalaseema, we had the elections in Kadapa, because after the death of Y.S. Rajshekhar Reddy, the former CM, we had the election in his constituency, and Mr. Jagan Mohan Reddy won. And that happened in Kadapa, but then Mr. Tarun Joshi, Dr. Tarun Joshi was the SP, and again a very upright man, a very fine officer. So the usual thing now as IG, you are more in the position of a mother-in-law's mother-in-law. SP is there, range DIG is there, so only you have to give support and guidance and protect the good people, they do the job. So it is a lot more easier than being SP of a district. And I was
IG means mother-in-law.
DIG is mother-in-law, IG is mother-in-law's mother-in-law, I would say. So you don't have that much of workload or stress or tension as you would have as an SP of a district, where you're directly involved in day-to-day basis. So my job was to give support and guidance to all the 5 SPs. Rayalaseema, as you all know how it is, so there would be a lot of pressure for posting of people of the right caste and their own caste and their own people. That we, not even in one case I would concede, not even in one case. It would be done only on merit, and whenever these transfers and postings were to be done, I will have a meeting in Tirupati of my SPs and range DIGs. We will have the entire data, the past record of every inspector. We will sit together. We will have details in a tabulated form, when he has joined, how many punishments, how many rewards, what is the intelligence report about him, what is his background, what is his contribution, everything, which are the important circles for us, which need greater attention, better officers and all that. And then there will be detailed discussion for 4 or 5 hours. And there itself will draw the proceedings. After consulting the SPs and range DIGs, draw the proceedings and issue the orders. So the whole thing will start around 10, and by 3 p.m., 4 p.m. we will be done, and I'll come back, and no consideration, any other consideration except for giving proper governance and giving inspectors who are good their due, recognizing their work, and not those who are otherwise having affiliations and who do things at the beck and call of. So that itself gave a very strong message.
No political postings.
Yeah, nothing like this was there, irrespective of the party. So there was certain pressures, but I did not concede, and maybe I'll tell you how. So, but nothing like this.
Sir, next to the coordination.
Yeah, then after that, I was brought to additional CP, law and order to the city police, and Telangana agitation was going on. Mr. Khan was my commissioner of police. I was there for a very short period because in any case, we were due for our promotion as additional DG. So I was relatively reluctant to join, because by the time you learn the job and you start becoming familiar, you will get your promotion and all that. But I was there as additional CP law and order for about 4 months, not a very long time. And during that time, we had Ganesh also. And Ganesh again is a, you know, annual examination for city police. So that got done in a very peaceful manner. And of course, the Telangana agitation was on, which was a daily thing. We had that Samajane Samula thing, SGS, for 37 days. And for those 37 days, I hardly slept for 4 hours every day. Because what will happen that during that agitation, there was always apprehension that the trains will be attacked. Trains and buses are most vulnerable to attacks by mobs. So we had to ensure that all the trains which reach Secunderabad or Nampally or Kachiguda, and generally most trains arrive in the morning between 5 to 7 a.m. And the threat will start from Zahirabad or many places as you enter Telangana, whether from Bangalore side or Delhi side, about 50-60 kilometers away from the city. So if the train is arriving, the time of arrival is around 5:30, we had to ensure that when it is even 60-70 kilometers away, that is around 3:30 a.m., it is fully escorted and it is fully covered by security. So in the morning itself, we had to ensure those parties have gone. So my work would start from 3 a.m., ensuring that all trains which are coming to Hyderabad or Secunderabad are well covered from 3 a.m. or 4 a.m. onwards till the time they reach. Then the trains have reached by about 7:30, 8 a.m. That is one part of the job which is over. Then from 10 a.m. onwards, you have the assembly, you have the secretariat, you have the government offices. So Vidhan Sabha, Vidyut Sabha is there, the assembly is there. All those places where you have the government offices, they have to be fully secure. You have to also ensure that the traffic moves smoothly and there are no agitators on the road and Osmania University is properly covered. And you also have to exercise extreme restraint because it is a popular movement. So while we have to see that it's a popular movement and it's a democratic country and you people should get a legitimate expression to their grievances or expression to whatever they want they are fighting for, but not at the cost of public order and disruption of traffic, etc. So it was a fine balance which we had to maintain. So throughout the day, these things you have to ensure that yes, they get chance to express themselves, they may have their demonstration, they may have their dharna, whatever, but not inconveniencing the people.
Okay.
And again in the evening, the trains will start departing from here from 7 p.m. onwards. And this will go on till 10 p.m. But again, you have to show that they have gone at least 60 kilometers beyond so that they are no more attacked. So my day will end at 11 p.m. So I would be able to get sleep only between around 11, 11:30 till about 3 a.m. For 37 days, it continued like this. So probably that was the toughest period in my life in terms of the sheer hard work which was involved. But I was not the only one. The entire team, right from Commissioner of Police to the lowest home guard, were a part of it. And I'm very happy that, unlike if you recollect in the 60s when you had the Telangana agitation, a very large number of people lost their life. This time it was zero, if I recollect correctly. Later on, I left for BSF, but no one died in the thing. And while maintaining law and order in a peaceful way and not causing any undue inconvenience to the public or disruption of traffic, the legitimate expressions of the people's aspirations of the people also got expression, as should be there in a democratic country, and a new state has come about.
4 months tarvata meeru
crime vachindi. I came to additional CP crime.
Sorry, 4 months em enduku cheyalsi vachindi land order lo? 4 months enduku chesaru meeru?
There was some difference of opinion which I can't bring on record in a public place. Maybe I'll tell you later on. So I was very keen to move out of the city police, but then I was told that if suddenly an officer of your profile, reputation and all is suddenly moved out in 4 months, so it will again give rise to rumors and lot of speculation in the media and the politicians. So, okay, you are having some issues with somebody, so we'll put you to crime and SIT. So I came to crime and SIT. After all, whatever the government decides, being a disciplined officer, you have to obey. So I came to crime and SIT and I was there again for a few months. Then again, there was very, very big case involving some 300 crores thing,
yeah,
in which I was not very happy with the day things were moving. And I found that there was certain amount of, I was facing certain pressures and conflicting and contradictory pressures and changing orders and instructions. I was not very comfortable. So, and the team below me was also getting compromised because 300 crores is a big amount. So then I requested that the post of welfare was lying vacant since additional DG Mr. Vivek Dubey had left that. And I asked, in writing, I asked that please post me to that place. Keep anybody of your choice over here, I'll be too happy. And it was gleefully accepted, so I immediately got to welfare and I was very happy there. And then I was in welfare for about 7-8 months as IG and additional DG, where we did some path-breaking work. Yes, in welfare, I can tell you, we brought out an entire compendium of all the welfare-related schemes of Andhra Pradesh government for the police. And I can say, whether it is AP or now it is Telangana, that this state has some of the most progressive schemes for police welfare across the country. In fact, I gave a presentation in this regard at that time in Government of India to a macro mission which is there on police welfare. We have Bhadrata, we have Arogya Bhadrata, and we have whole lot of schemes giving educational loans, different types of other things. So all that I brought them together in one comprehensive compendium. Reason being that in our country, the lack of knowledge is a huge problem, and that gives rise to corruption. So if a constable has to apply for a loan, he does not know what documents he is supposed to furnish, how he has to fill up the form, how should he go about it, and every level he is harassed by our own internal bureaucracy or DPO staff and whatever. So I brought everything together in the form of a compendium and distributed right up to the police station level, put it on online also, and made it in a very, very simple way. So that gave awareness that if somebody has to apply, I should go about it. Second thing is, we made that all the remittance of money will be done online. So somebody has applied for a loan, maybe 50,000 or 5 lakhs, money will go directly into his bank account. He doesn't have to wait for a check, because again, getting a check involves corruption. So there was a lot of resistance, we ensured that. Then under Arogya Bhatta also, we wrote to the government and we requested them that in any case, since parents are entitled to reimbursement of parents of a government servant, why not it be covered? So that was accepted, and later on, the parents are covered up to the extent of 1 lakh each parent per year. So that was another thing we could get through. I got for the children of the deceased police personnel who have lost their life in Noxnard violence, we got a beautiful residential building constructed for them in Ambarpet. Very nice building was constructed for the children, and we ensured that these children their education is totally free, their boarding and lodging is made free. We added a library, we added a computer center over there. So these were some of the things which we did. Then this police canteens, just as army has CSD canteens, we have CPC, Central Police Canteens. Unfortunately, though this concept had come about almost, I think, 15-20 years back, at that point of time, and I am talking of 2012, there was not even one police canteen in AP,
okay,
or for that matter Telangana, not even one canteen. So I took it up in a big way with the Government of India, with the society, it's something called the WARB, Welfare and Rehabilitation Board, which is in charge in Government of India. We took with them, and I got large number of police canteens allotted. We started the construction, and the first one came about in Yusufwala battalion only, another one in Vishakhapatnam, third one in Vijayawada while I was there. They got sanctioned. So I got sanction actually for 13 police canteens in this state. So, and that is, now there is a canteen in our, but I mean our academy also.
Oh.
So, which gives benefit of 20-30% on different products. So it is cheaper, even in electronic items. A TV which may otherwise be costing in the market for 20,000, is available with us for about 15,000. So, it's a huge benefit to the constabulary. So, that was another thing which was done during my time. And
Next, of course,
I went to Border Security Force.
Yeah.
Border Security Force has its own ethos, it has its own culture, it's a very different milieu. Their job, I would say, it is first of all the biggest border guarding force in the world, with a strength of about 2,75,000. It is guarding the borders with Pakistan and Bangladesh. For me also, despite being an IPS officer and having been in the service for such a long time, it was a revelation. Each one of us, we have a general perception that it is the army which guards the borders. Nothing is farther from the truth. Because as per international conventions, borders between any two countries have to be guarded only by police forces. Army cannot be there. This is the law. This is the rule as per international conventions. Therefore, the entire border of India with Pakistan, with Bangladesh, 100% is with BSF, 4,095 kilometers. There is no army. There is no army with India's border with Bangladesh. Likewise, the 97% plus of the Indo-Pakistan border is with BSF. Army is available only on very few areas, which is part of what is known as LOC, line of control.
Yeah.
Which is the area which is of dispute. So you would be seeing in the papers, you know, they write about Indo-Pakistan firing in Jammu. It is essentially the BSF, Border Security Force,
not
the army.
Yeah.
Army is there on the disputed areas, which is less than 2 to 3% of the total. And even in those areas, BSF is there. And again, BSF has, you know, in terms of weaponry, they have their own artillery. We don't have, of course, the Bofors, which is 155 mm, but we have up to 115 mm guns also. And very professional force. Their mandate is limited in nature. Unlike the civil police, which does large amount of duties of different types, it is only border guarding and border guarding alone for BSF, but they do it very well. And there's tremendous focus on training. But again, each organization has its problems, that also has its problems. One big problem is that unlike the army, where we have system of peacetime and peacetime postings and field postings and non-field, and people can come to cantonments, stay with families. BSF, every jawan keeps moving from one border to another. So today he may be on Tripura border, second day he may be on Rajasthan border, third day he may be on Kashmir border. There is no system of cantonments as you have in the army. So there is a tremendous sense of, you know, you are away from your family throughout your life. So that was one issue which needs to be addressed, and it is being addressed progressively in a very positive manner. But it has its own challenges and pressures and stresses which get built up on the jawans and also on the officers. And that was again a very good experience. I was first of all in Calcutta. And Calcutta frontier, what is called the South Bengal frontier, is considered to be the most challenging frontier in BSF. Reason being that that frontier is most vulnerable to three types of crime. One is cattle smuggling, and it is estimated that the cattle smuggling from India to Bangladesh, there is an Hindustan Times article also, is in the range of around 7,000 to 8,000 crores per annum. That is one thing. Second thing is, of course, illegal immigration. The illicit human trafficking and immigration, people coming, Rohingyas and everybody, Bangladesh is coming into India. That is another problem. And the third is FICN, fake Indian fake currency
from
Bangladesh. So in Malda area, you know, maximum FICN gets pumped into India from Malda. Particularly two villages called Churyantpur and Kaliachak. Tremendous influx of fake currencies there. In fact, even when I was there in Karnool, in Adilabad, in Vizag, and most of our SPs, whenever we catch fake currency and we start unraveling the mystery, we start going backward as to how to start establishing the backward linkages, ultimately it leads to Malda. Ke saab Malda se India mein aaya tha. From beyond Malda, it is goes into Bangladesh or Pakistan, whatever. So that is the most challenging frontier. So we did a lot of work over there. In BSF, in Calcutta, to minimize influx of fake currency, to control cattle smuggling, and also to see that illegal immigration doesn't take place. I would like to mention that at that point of time in 2013, when I was there in Calcutta, this is all now almost 6 years back, I wrote a detailed report talking about the influx of Rohingya Muslims.
Oh.
And when I was in court, that was the first time that Rohingya Muslims were being sort of being apprehended, and we did interrogation, and we found that we did not have experts to speak in their language. Most of us speak either in English or Hindi or Bangla or Urdu, isn't it? Of course, Telugu is a local language, but at the borders. So Hindi, English, Bangla, Urdu. Because it's a border with Bangladesh, Bengal mein Bengali bolte. But these guys have a very different language. So even when we are trying to do interrogation of these people, the language which they speak, which is I think Rakhne or Rakhie, something like this, none was able to speak. So how do you interrogate them? How did you come inside? Who helped you? Who assisted you? And nothing will be there. So then I report saying that we need to have people, experts who know the language. We used to get one professor from Jadavpur University, హూ వాజ్ నోయింగ్ దిస్ లాంగ్వేజ్ అండ్ హీ విల్ ట్రాన్స్లేట్ డ్యూరింగ్ ఇంట్రోగేషన్ కి భయ్యే క్యా బోల్ రే అండ్ దెన్ ఐ అన్వేల్డ్ ఏ ప్లాన్ విచ్ ఐ కాంట్ టెల్ ఇన్ దిస్ ఇంటర్వ్యూ అబౌట్ ఎ పర్టికులర్ కంట్రీ విచ్ వాజ్ ఇన్వాల్వింగ్ ఇట్స్ సెల్ఫ్ ఇన్ ఎన్ష్యూరింగ్ దట్ దిస్ రోహింగ్యాస్ దే గెట్ ఎ స్మూత్ ప్యాసేజ్ అక్రాస్ బంగ్లాదేశ్ ఫ్రామ్ బర్మా దే ఆర్ థ్రోన్ ఇన్ టు ఇండియా అండ్ దెన్ ఇట్ బికమ్స్ ఇండియాస్ ప్రాబ్లమ్ సో ఐ డిడ్ సమ్ స్టడీ ఆన్ దాట్ సబ్మిటెడ్ ఎ రిపోర్ట్ దెన్ దే వాస్ సమ్ ఫాలో అప్ యాక్షన్ విచ్ వీ కాంట్ ఆఫ్ కోర్స్ టెల్ ఆన్ రికార్డ్
హౌ మెనీ ఇయర్స్ ఇన్ బిఎస్ ఆఫ్
ఫైవ్ ఇయర్స్
ఆఫ్టర్ దట్
ఆఫ్టర్ కల్కటా ఐ వాజ్ ఇన్ దేర్ అకాడమీ అకాడమీ టెకన్పూర్ విచ్ ఇస్ స్ప్రెడ్ ఓవర్ 3,000 acres ఇట్స్ ఎ బ్యూటిఫుల్ క్యాంపస్ నియర్ గ్వాలియర్ అండ్ ఐ వాజ్ అఫిషియేటింగ్ యాజ్ అ డైరెక్టర్ ఓవర్ దేర్ ది యాక్చువల్ డైరెక్టర్ విల్ బి సిట్టింగ్ ఇన్ ఢిల్లీ బికాస్ దేర్ వాజ్ షార్టేజ్ ఆఫ్ ఆఫీసర్స్ అండ్ ఫ్రమ్ దేర్ ఐ వెంట్ టు గాంధీనగర్ ఐ వాజ్ దేర్ ఫర్ 2 years ఇన్ గాంధీనగర్ గాంధీనగర్ ఐ వాజ్ ఇన్ చార్జ్ ఆఫ్ ఎంటైర్ గుజరాత్ బార్డర్ అండ్ సమ్ పోర్షన్ ఆఫ్ రాజస్థాన్ బార్డర్ దట్ అగైన్ వాజ్ ఎ వెరీ బిగ్ ఏరియా నాట్ వెరీ నాట్ మెనీ పీపుల్ నో దట్ ది 1965 ఇండో పాక్ వార్ యాక్చువల్లీ బిగ్యాన్ ఇన్ గుజరాత్ బార్డర్ ఆన్ గుజరాత్ బార్డర్ అండ్ ది పాకిస్తానీ ఆర్మీ మేడ్ డీప్ ఇన్ రోడ్స్ ఇన్ కచ్ ఏరియా and they overran several military posts and in the wake of the reverses or the setbacks which were suffered by us in 65 this border security force was raised as a specialized agency for border guarding so that was again a very challenging task it's a very very large border and it has very very difficult terrain thereafter I came to Delhi I was IG Purse there it is appears to be very innocuous but IG Purse is a very very key post in any of these CAPFs because you are in charge for recruitment you are in charge for training you are in charge for induction at different levels and their deployment their postings you are also the chief vigilance officer of the organization so it's a very prestigious and a very heavy assignment after that I came back and now I am again back to my cadre jise hum Maika bolte hain as director of this academy
sir అప్పాకి వచ్చిన తర్వాత సారీ తెలంగాణ పోలీస్ అకాడమీ డైరెక్టర్కి వచ్చిన తర్వాత మీరు చేస్తున్న రిఫార్మ్స్ ఎక్కడ ఉన్నాయండి
వీ హ్యావ్ కలెక్టివ్లీ యాజ్ ఎ టీమ్ ఇన్ అకాడమీ వీ హ్యావ్ డన్ లాట్ ఆఫ్ థింగ్స్ అండ్ ఐ వుడ్ సే అట్ ది వెరీ అవుట్ సైడ్ దట్ ది క్రెడిట్ గోస్ టు ద ప్రెసెంట్ డీజీపీ మిస్టర్ మహేందర్ రెడ్డి హీఈస్ ఏ డీప్లీ అనలిటికల్ పర్సన్ ఏ గ్రేట్ విజనరీ ఎక్స్ట్రీమ్లీ హార్డ్ వర్కింగ్ ఉంటే దిమాగ్మే కామ్ కలవా కుచ్ రతీ నీ దినభర్ కామ్ కడతే సవే సే రాత్ తక్ ఇట్ ఇస్ ఆల్ అబౌట్ పోలీసింగ్ హౌ టు ఇంప్రూవ్ ది ఇమేజ్ ఆఫ్ పోలీస్ హౌ టు ఎన్హాన్స్ ది ఎఫిషియన్సీ సో వీ ఆర్ వెరీ లక్కీ అండ్ ఫార్చునేట్ టు హ్యావ్ ఎ డీజీ లైక్ హిమ్ అండ్ ఐ థింక్ హీ హెస్ ప్రబలీ ది ఓన్లీ డీజీపీ డట్ ఐ హ్యావ్ కమ్ అక్రాస్ అండ్ మేబీ ఇన్ ది ఎంటైర్ కంట్రీ హూ హ్యాస్ నాట్ ఓన్లీ విజిటెడ్ ది అకాడమీ బట్ హీ హెస్ స్పెండ్ ఫుల్ డే విత్ ది cadet SIs and all that. He'll come at 11 and he'll be here till 7 p.m. 8 a.m. having detailed discussion with the cadet SIs, with the faculty members. So during that we identified a certain certain lacunae in our training curriculum, our this, and he wanted us that these people, our cadet SIs, their focus should be more on professional things, core policing, IPC, the law subjects, forensic science, investigation of cases, station house management. So under his guidance and with his support, we have greatly changed the syllabus, the curriculum for the cadet SIs and also for the direct DSPs. So it has become more professional in approach, cutting down the frills and so that they get greater expertise, knowledge and skills in their core competence, what they are required to do when they are in charge of police stations or subdivision. So that revision of the syllabus was a major task which we have undertaken. That has been almost completed. It has been done, and it's a major exercise, and it will be useful not only for Telangana police. We are going to be sharing it with all the state police academies because, after all, it's the same thing. All the SIs across the country, they are expected to know Indian Penal Code, Criminal Procedure Code, Evidence Act, investigation, the way to carry out investigation, etc. So police stations remain the same, barring minor modifications across the country. So it will be useful. This revised syllabus will be useful to the state police academies across the country. That is one big thing that we have done in the last 1 year or so. Another thing we have done is that we found that TSPA, this academy, earlier APPA, had its own publications and own study material. So whether it is station house management or leadership or ethics or IPC, we used to provide them a study material. Kya padhana hai us subject mein? But this study material somehow, for whatever reason, in many subjects has not been revised for decades. Some material is almost 20 years old, 25 years old, whereas in this period so many changes have come about in the law, in the interpretation of law, judgments, scientific advancements have taken place, technology has changed.
Cybercrime.
All these things. So, we have undertaken a major revision and updation of our own study material.
Okay.
So, that is also going on. Almost 40-50% work is over. So, we have already revised the things in forensic science and forensic medicine. We have done the revision in all the law subjects, IPC, CRPC. We have, you know, incorporated the latest judgments of the Supreme Courts and High Courts because they are the courts of record. That has been done. We have done on station house management. A few other things are going on. Hopefully, in another 1 or 2 months, we will be able to complete this entire exercise. Third thing is that we started what was called faculty development program. Because till that time, the faculty itself has not been updated. How can they impart the knowledge, the latest things to the cadet size? So, in the gap that we had after the passing out parade of the previous batch, we had some about 1 month, 1.5 months. For each course, for each subject, we got the best faculty from across the country. And we told our own faculty, aap bataiye, whom do you want, what topic you want to be covered so that your knowledge gets updated.
Yeah.
So, under this faculty development program, we got large number of highly specialized, people who were really experts and who have done some cutting edge work in their respective fields, whether it is law, whether it is forensic science, whether it is investigation. And they have come and they have addressed our faculty so that their knowledge gets updated, which they will be able to disseminate to other people, to the cadets, probationary SIs and DSPs, etc. So, that was another thing which gave me a lot of satisfaction, faculty development program. Plus, of course, the devil lies in the details. So, the daily routine and ensuring that courses go on, we have what is called the mandatory courses. So, each SI before he becomes inspector of police, he is supposed to do 5 courses ranging from forensic science to cyber crime to essential law to station house management, etc. Each of these courses are 2 weeks duration. But we found that a large number of sub-inspectors of police, they have not undergone, which means one, they cannot be promoted. Second thing, they have not been updated. So, since they have passed out 10 years back, in 10 years, a lot of changes have taken place. So, this focus on mandatory courses has been renewed, and we are in touch with all the district SPs, with the zonal IGs, range DIGs, telling them that in your district, in your range, in your zone, these SIs have not undergone these courses. Please send them to us, and we have increased this number of courses, their frequency, so that more sub-inspectors get a chance to undergo these courses. So, that is another thing that we have taken up. Oh, these are a few things which come to my mind. Okay.
Sir, final ga rendu questions. Santosh Mehra gar eppudu navvuto untaru. Santosh Mehra gar men welfare ki ekkuva untaru. Kan Santosh Mehra gariki kopam vaste ade range lo untadi. Oh, question.
Is there?
Kopam vaste chaala barashtu adu. Kani kopam paalu pongu lage untadi anadi okati. Second, police department lo vache aspirants ki మీరు ఇచ్చే అడ్వైజ్ ఏంటండి? ఆల్రెడీ డిపార్ట్మెంట్లో ఉన్న వాళ్ళకి మీరు ఇచ్చే అడ్వైజ్ ఏంటండి?
సీ, వన్ థింగ్ యూ మస్ట్ అండర్స్టాండ్ దట్ వీఆర్ ఆల్ హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్స్. నన్ ఆఫ్ అస్ ఇస్ పర్ఫెక్ట్. ఈచ్ వన్ ఆఫ్ హ్యాస్ హిస్ ఓన్ వీక్నెసెస్, ఫీలింగ్స్, వల్నరబిలిటీస్ అండ్ ఆల్ దాట్. ఐఎమ్ ఆల్సో హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్. దట్ ఈస్ వన్ థింగ్. ఐ డూ స్ట్రైవ్ ఫర్ ఎక్సలెన్స్ ఇఫ్ నాట్ పర్ఫెక్షన్. ఐ డూ ఫీల్ దట్ వీఆర్ ఇన్ ఎ జాబ్ where we should have zero failure rate because we are dealing with the lives of people.
Yes.
After all, for every individual, any individual for that matter, 3 things are most important. The safety and security of his life and health, his honor and his property, isn't it? And as a policeman, we are dealing with these 3 things which are most precious to an individual. Honor to a woman, if her modesty gets outraged or if she is subjected to rape, her honor is compromised. Property of an individual, his purse, his mobile phone, a woman's chain, his land, all these things. So, we are dealing with things which are most precious to an individual, and therefore our standards of performance, our standards of knowledge, expertise and skills have to be of the highest order as an average policeman. Now, again, who is supposed to set these standards, who are supposed to inculcate these values and knowledge skills? It is academy. Academy is a temple of learning. And having worked in BSF and having seen the defense services at court quarters, I feel very strongly about it. And I wish that the concerned people take notice of it, that unlike the paramilitary forces and the defense forces, where there is tremendous focus done on academies and training institutions, and the best of people are posted there. Because if the best people do not impart training, if the people, the standards and the reputation of people is suboptimal, how can they give good training? Unfortunately, by and large, in state police academies, the quality and the caliber and even the integrity of people that get posted is not of the desired level. We in Telangana are a lot better, but there is some scope for improvement. And that at times, I find it to be frustrating, I must admit. I feel that if we have people of the right integrity and commitment, I'm not talking about competence, I'm talking about commitment, perhaps the academy can do a lot better. And then when we are dealing with cadet SIs or probation DSPs, they are watching us. If I am a very heavy person, 100 kg weight or something, and I am on the ground and I can't march properly, or I can't salute properly, or I can't run properly, and I am telling this cadet SIs to do 100 meters in 15 seconds, what moral authority will I have? And they laugh at me. As simple as that. So I do have demanding, exacting standards for myself, and I expect the same from the people who work with me. It's all in the interest of the organization and the police force for which I work. I feel that I should give my level best. And as director, it's my job, it's my mandate to ensure that whoever is working here, he gives out his best. And we are good role models for every trainee and course participant here. If a trainee or course participant feels that I am not up to the mark, it's not only that he will lose respect for me, his learning will get adversely impacted. So I am of the confirmed opinion that academy should attract the best talent, and whoever is available here should constantly and consciously strive to live up to the exacting standards, because we are being watched by these cadet SIs who are the future of this force for the next 30-35 years. How we train them, that will decide the future of policing in this country.
Okay. Police department lo vache vallu nirantaram training chestu oka role model ga undalantunnaru Santosh Mehra garu. ముందు మనం జనానికి చెప్పే బదులు ఎస్ఎస్ కానీ డిఎస్పీకి చెప్పేటప్పుడు ముందు మన రోల్ మోడల్గా ఉండి కరెక్ట్గా ఉంటే వాళ్ళు ఆటోమేటిక్గా అదే రోడ్లో వెళ్తారని సంతోష్ మెహ్రా గారు చెప్తారు. సంతోష్ మెహ్రా గారు ఐపీఎస్ ఒకటే చేయలేదు, అతను యుఎస్లో మాస్టర్ డిగ్రీ చేసి అసలు మెకానిజం కానీ అతను ఆలోచనలు డిఫరెంట్గా ఉంటాయి కాబట్టి గవర్నమెంట్ కూడా అతనికి అప్పా డైరెక్టర్గా ఇచ్చి రాబోయే కాలంలో తెలంగాణలో పోలీసులు అందరూ కూడా స్టేట్ వైడ్గా ఒక రోల్ మోడల్గా ఉండడానికి సంతోష్ మెహ్రా గారి ఆలోచనలు దానికి కరెక్ట్గా వెళ్తాయని కాబట్టి అప్పాలా ఉన్నారు ప్రస్తుతం. సంతోష్ మెహ్రా గారి అతని ఆలోచన మేరకు రాబోయే రోజుల్లో తెలంగాణ పోలీసులు చాలా ముందుకుండి కొంత టోటల్గా ఇండియాకే తెలంగాణ పోలీసు ఒక రోల్ మోడల్గా ఉంటారనేది ఖచ్చితంగా జరుగుతుంది. ఇది ఈ వారం సంతోష్ మెహ్రా గారితో ఎక్సలెంట్ ఇంటర్వ్యూ. వచ్చేవారు మరో గెస్ట్తో మళ్ళీ కలుద్దాం. అంతవరకు నమస్కారం.
మీరందరూ కూడా ఐ డ్రీమ్ ఛానల్ని సబ్స్క్రైబ్ చేయాలని కోరుకుంటున్నాను.
ఐఎమ్ సుచరిత, హోమ్ మినిస్టర్ ఆఫ్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్. ఫర్ మోర్ వీడియోస్ సబ్స్క్రైబ్ ఐ డ్రీమ్స్.
మీ చిల్ల జగ్గిరెడ్డి, ఎమ్మెల్యే, కొత్తపేట. ఫర్ మోర్ వీడియోస్ ప్లీజ్ సబ్స్క్రైబ్ ఐ డ్రీమ్.
ఫర్ మోర్ వీడియోస్ ప్లీజ్ సబ్స్క్రైబ్ ఐ డ్రీమ్.
నేను మీ జక్కంపూడి రాజా. ఫర్ మోర్ వీడియోస్ ప్లీజ్ సబ్స్క్రైబ్ ఐ డ్రీమ్స్.
ఐఎమ్ రేవతి చౌదరి. ఫర్ మోర్ వీడియోస్ ప్లీజ్ సబ్స్క్రైబ్ ఐ డ్రీమ్.
ఫర్ మోర్ వీడియోస్ ప్లీజ్ సబ్స్క్రైబ్ టు ఐ డ్రీమ్.
For more videos, please subscribe I Dream.
I am Vasireddi Padma, Chairperson of State Women Commission. For more videos, please subscribe I Dream.